reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Again, the Lord spoke to Ahaz, saying, "Ask a sign of the Lord your God. Let it be as deep as Sheol or as high as heaven." But Ahaz said, "I will not ask, and I will not put the Lord to the test." Then Isaiah said, "Hear then, O house of David, is it too little for you to weary mortals, that you weary my God also? Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Look, the young woman is with child, and shall bear a son, and shall name him Emmanuel." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. It is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. Consequently, when Christ came into the world, he said, "Sacrifices and offerings you have not desired, but a body you have prepared for me. In burnt offerings and sin offerings you have taken no pleasure." Then I said, "See, God, I have come to do your will, O God. In the scroll of the book it is written of me." When Christ said, "You have neither desired nor taken pleasure in sacrifices and offerings and burnt offerings and sin offerings, these are offered according to the law," then he added, "See, I have come to do your will." He abolishes the first in order to establish the second. And it is by God's will that we are sanctified through offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
How often have you been confronted in your life with a situation you did not really want to accept? A child who no longer is under your care, but who seems to be doing everything he or she can to derail his or her life. A friend who's behaving in manners that strike you as self-destructive, but which he or she has chosen to see as perfectly logical. Events at the office that seem to be leaving you somewhere you wish not to be. A report from the doctor that is not what you expected or wished. An acquaintance who offers you some observations about yourself that you do not particularly care for. I suspect you get my drift. More often than not, it strikes me that in situations such as these, our response, at least I know mine is, our response is either to ignore or counteract or lash out. A case in point. I used to ride a train to work in New York. I was a young man in the advertising business and was quite certain I knew everything worth knowing. Back in those days, the commuter trains between Connecticut and New York had a section of seats which faced one another. On the way home in the evening, my chums and I usually sat there smoking and having a few drinks. We thought we were the cat's meow. We often got quite noisy and, I hate to admit it, almost undoubtedly slightly obnoxious. One evening, a woman who worked at the same firm as I was riding in the car my chums and I were disrupting. As she disembarked at her station, she turned to me and said, "You know, Bob, you're acting like a perfect prat." I ignored her and suspect after she left, probably said something unkind. In the weeks that followed, I found I could not help reflecting upon her comment. And in fact, eventually had to look in the mirror and say, "Robert, she is correct. It is time to grow up." And so I came to ride in a regular seat, read the paper, and tend to my own affairs. As far as train riding etiquette, I did grow up. Something new came into being for me. To do that, I had to accept something that I really did not want to accept, an assessment of me that was not very flattering, but was quite accurate. I, over the years, have come to think of this process as accepting the unacceptable. It applies to all the situations I noted earlier and 1,000 others I suspect each of us is clear about in our own lives. To accept that which is difficult to accept, which is unacceptable, but which is the truth, is amongst the most difficult steps on the human journey. It is also the most essential to move forward in that journey. Accepting the unacceptable is not willy-nilly saying, "Oh, sure, that's just fine," to situations we can do something about and which need something to be done about them, but it is about seeing the truth and accepting that which is true and able to be changed, even if we don't like it, think it's unfair, and wish it would go away. For a young woman of 2,000 years ago to find she was pregnant out of wedlock was, in essence, a death sentence, literally. And Mary finds herself in just such a state. It cannot be. She is a virgin. and yet it is true. She asks her mysterious visitor how such a thing can be. She argues that it cannot be, but eventually she is clear that it is the truth, and her response is to accept the unacceptable. Somehow or another, this is the will of God, the truth from above. There is something going on here that she cannot fathom. She can either accept or not accept. Even 2,000 years ago, there were manners in which pregnancy could be terminated at great risk, but terminated indeed. She could have chosen that course, but she did not. Accepting the unacceptable, acknowledging that we may not be able to understand why something is happening. We are afraid of it. We would rather it weren't the truth, but we accept it finally because it is the truth. What, oh, what would have happened if Mary had chosen not to accept? God works through us just as God worked through Mary. That is where God's purposes are worked out, in this world, amongst us, and often through people who are utterly unlikely, who don't really understand the role they are playing at the time, but who accept the unacceptable, who acknowledge the truth. Do you have something or someone that you need to accept in order to move forward in your life? Clearly, I did. Something that may be painful or uncertain, accept in order to move in the direction God wills you to move, but in which you are not certain you wish to go. I wonder if the feast we celebrate this evening mightn't offer us the opportunity to reflect upon the possibility of accepting that which is unacceptable, but through which God may be seeking to do something we cannot fathom, to open us to new possibilities, new life, new relationships, new hope, new understanding. Let it be with me according to your word. Those words echo across the ages, and with them, our salvation came to be. It is no different with us than it was with Mary. Salvation, health, and wholeness is waiting to be born, born in and for each of us. But we must allow its birth. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Lord God, you chose the Blessed Virgin Mary to be the mother of your incarnate Son. Through her courage and faith, your plan for the salvation of humankind was made possible. Have mercy upon all who look for your gift of salvation. We pray for those who are not able to trust in your promises, and for those who refuse to hear your call upon their lives. Help us to break down barriers of race, gender, and social status, so that all may live in the peace and freedom that you have intended for the whole world.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear your prayer.
Lord God, you sent Gabriel to give Mary your message of peace and joy. Give your church the energy and the vision to share your good news of salvation. We pray for all who lead your church, for bishops, priests, deacons, and other pastors. Fill them with your spirit of truth and guide them to speak the words that will lead others to Christ. We pray for all who are discerning a call to the ordained ministry of your church and ask that you would give all Christian people the wisdom and courage to live out the unique vocation entrusted to them.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, you look with love on the humble and fill the hungry with your gifts. We pray for the oppressed, and we seek your healing grace for all who suffer in our world. We hold before you all who are affected by acts of violence, natural disaster, and disease. Comfort those who have been affected by flooding rain in recent days, and for all who face an uncertain future. Raise up the downcast, help all in need, comfort and strengthen the dying.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, you alone work wonders, and with you all things are possible. We thank you for the life and witness of the Blessed Virgin Mary and for her example of selfless discipleship. We pray for the souls of those who have gone before us, that they will know the fullness of your salvation and the abundance of eternal life. We commit to your merciful keeping the souls of those who have died in recent days, particularly Charles Dale, Zomi Frankham, Alan Greenhall, as well as those who have died in acts of violence or natural disasters, and all whose year's mind occurs at this time, particularly Mary Mace, William Carter, Tony Parkinson, priest. Rest eternal grant unto them, O Lord.
Lord, in your mercy,
therefore humbly confess our sins in penitence and faith. confident that God will raise us up. Merciful God, our Maker and our Judge, we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have failed to do. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We repent and are sorry for
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness, we have these gifts to share. Accept and use our offerings for your glory and for the service of your kingdom.
Blessed be God forever.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. And praise for your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, who was born and lived as one of us. By his death on the cross and rising to new life, he offered the one true sacrifice for sin, and obtained an eternal deliverance for his people. And now we give you thanks for the obedience of your servant Mary, who by your grace answered your call to be the mother of your Son. With all generations, we call her blessed, and with her we rejoice in the greatness of your salvation. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious. for these gifts of your creation, this bread and wine. And we pray that by your word and Holy Spirit, we who eat and drink them may be partakers of Christ's body and blood. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread. And when he had given you thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take it. This is my body given for you. Remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup, and again giving you thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Let us proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Therefore we do as our Savior has commanded, proclaiming his offering of himself, made once for all upon the cross, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming again, we celebrate with this bread and this cup his one perfect and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. Renew us by your Holy Spirit. Unite us in the body of your Son, and bring us with all your people into the joy of your eternal kingdom. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, with whom and in whom, in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, we worship you, Father, in songs of never-ending praise.
Blessing and honor and glory and power, our Lord's
taught us, we are confident to pray.
Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Happy are those who are called to his supper.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed.